States, using banning of Hawaiian forest birds to help determine how climate influences demography through regulating fish. Right arrow, that's.
Oh, the right arrow, that's for.
Thanks.
Thanks very much. Bird and plant communities in Hawaii have been subject to persistent habitat change, but probably most of you have heard about it. And climate change has become a real factor for them in recent years. The last 30 years, a severe drought has occurred in Hawaii, where the rainfall has really decreased markedly every decade. Now, this climate change is probably affecting birds markedly. I'll talk about that a little bit and bring in one of the things that's really important for you. Got a flash there.
Sorry.
That's all right. I'll forgive you. About the climate change probably affects birds, all birds, through bottom-up process. And before I get into that, I want to talk about what each of you can, and most of you are, doing through your banding activities, providing value added to most of the monitoring that folks do. 95% of what you hear about monitoring is population size, from censuses of various kinds, e-bird, Christmas bird count. But what you're doing is what I refer to as value added. You're providing lots and lots of information that can be got no other way and is terribly, terribly important. The physical measurements, the physiological estimates, and the calculations of vital rates give an idea of why a species is where it is and what it's doing, not just where it is and how many there are. Demographic monitoring in human terms is not usually applied to birds and should be. Demographic monitoring in human terms includes such things as ethnicity, food habits, various things like that, but they should apply to birds as well. And the information that most of you, or many of you, are getting, whether you're working in Kalamazoo or Kauai, are providing the frequency, magnitude, and phenology of various attributes of the birds. Certainly breeding success and survival, but also food, health, physiology, and things like that. So what is the bottom-up process? Well, the classic example is Peter and Rosemary's Grant's medium ground finches in the Galapagos. Simple system, small island that they studied. Nestlings provision their kids with caterpillars. Well, there's more rain, say in El Nino year, there's more caterpillars, the population increases, and eventually they run into a barrier of not enough competition for nest sites. And this competition rears its ugly head, and the top-down processes such as predation come in and start interacting. We don't have the wonderful data that the Grants had on all aspects of the birds, but we were fortunate in our studies in Hawaii to have some pretty good information on it. Our studies on a big island, one of the study sites called Keaho. There we did monthly sampling over a period of several years, examining all aspects of the bird's life that I could possibly think of. We created these metrics and data sets to help us understand how climate can affect the resources, the food resources, and then the birds. We modeled a variety of systems to examine the climate change on them. All the bird metrics and climate data at five native forest sites we took in the mid-70s and 80s, long before most of you were born, of course. Well, maybe most of you. Some of you. Data included census, of course, activity budgets, food analysis, mist netting, and all the good stuff that we get from mist netting. Plume range and territory of Clearmarked birds, phenology of fruits, flowers, and insects. Only now, I like to excuse my work, only now we have the statistical capability to really analyze these in all their complexities. The data is unique in its breadth. Here are the various data sets that we have, including banding the big blue down there. And there's lots and lots of questions that you can answer by putting all these data sets together. The taking a subset of the data that I'll talk about today is how to examine the bottom-up effects of climate. We use structural equation models to determine how birds manipulate their life history in relationship to various aspects of the environment, both the climate and the vegetation, fruits and flowers. Use two species, two sets of species. One set, two specialist nectarivores, the ivy and the apapani, that and how they respond. Based on activity budgets where we followed the birds around and saw exactly what they fed on, we knew that they were really into two species of flowers, primarily one called the Ohia and one called the Nile. There'll be a quiz later about those species. And they differed between years on the abundance of fruiting and flowers. Now, in this not terribly simple graph, is structural the structural equation model, which is a mathematical term for taking the entire biology of the bird and putting it into terms that we can understand. Here are the apapani on the left, the right-wing bird there is the ivy. And down below is the climate, the temperature and rainfall in each month, and how it affects, how it's related to the flowering of those two species of plants that the nectarivores feed on, the Nile and the Ohia. And then in turn, how these are related statistically now to the timing and frequency of molt and breeding. Now, those numbers up there, the R squared number, which probably is somewhere there, there's a pointer, that's right. 65%, that explains how much, that says how much of the variance is of the timing and abundance of molt and breeding is explained, that's all derived from banding, of course, explained by the combination of these factors. Very simple models, but a lot of variation is explained. And switching now to another one based on banding, survivorship. The flower abundance is in the top model of both, and predictably survival seasonal changes. There's a large drop in late in the winters, and a large drop in the winter of 1980 when both flowers were unseasonably low in productivity. So these are obviously responding, at least statistically, to the availability of resources. Generalists that we looked at there, among other species, are the amakihi and the white eye. One's native, one's not native. You can probably guess which one is which. And they eat, in addition to nectar, also fruits and flowers. So we included these in the equation model. And here we included other species of flower and also a couple of species of fruit. In this case, I forgot to mention, the red arrows are negative relationships and black arrows are positive. And so as they go up, in this particular case for the generalist, they explain less, or a little more than a third in one species, almost half in the other, of the relationship, and telling us a great deal about what's going on. Looking at survival by comparison, we see, well, What do you see there? Very stable survivorship over the years. And even in that rough winter, in the winter of 1980, there was only a slight decrease was going on. Okay. So to conclude, the structural equation models tell us that the birds structure their timing of breeding and molting around the availability of the fruit and flowers, which depends on the climate. And specialists are more sensitive than generalists. Our results were only possible by combining multiple data sets of not just the censuses, but also the various things we get from banding and doing their behavior, and understand this complexity of relationships. While it's time-consuming, intensive bird monitoring, including banding, most importantly, I would say, it makes it possible to understand the regulatory mechanisms of bird populations of interest and what's limiting the populations. You only do the censuses, you only do the demographic, you don't get the whole picture and really understand it. Finally, we strongly suggest that researchers continue revisiting legacy data sets such as this to apply contemporary statistical methods to these older data. There's data sitting out there among the folks here of hundreds of thousands of records, well taken, a lot of devotion, that with these new methods, we can really make lots of silk purses out of it.
We have plenty of time for questions.
Yeah, they got 2 minutes.
I'm giving you even more.